بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة على سيد المرسلين. This is Dr. Zulfa. We know each other before. I taught you many subjects and I'm happy that you are in the last semester now and you will be awarded your certificates, inshallah, by the end of this semester. In this semester, I'll teach you two fields of linguistics, which are morphology and syntax. What is morphology? What is morphology? Can you remember? Refresh your mind, refresh your memory. Okay, morphology is the study of word formation, and syntax is the study of sentence formation. We'll study these things in details. Actually, you had an idea about them in linguistics in grade and level two, I think. But today, or in this semester, we'll study them in details. Let's go step by step, one step followed by the other. Look at slide two, morphology and word formation definition. In linguistics, morphology is the study of words, is the study of words and how they are formed. It analyzes the structure of words and parts of words, such as stems, root words, prefixes, and suffixes, which are called affixes. What do we mean by that? We say morphology studies the structure of a word. When I say structure, it means more than one part combined together. Our words consist of structures? Yes. To explain, let's take a word like helpful or unhelpful. The central word or the basic part or what we call the root of the word, which carries the meaning or which carries the message, the main meaning of the word is help. It's a full word, complete word that gives meaning, help. But is this the word we have when we say unhelpful? Is this the word we are studying? No. It consists of this word, unhelpful, consists of three parts. So this is the structure of the word. When I say comfortable, the root part or the main part, which carries the meaning, or the base of the word is comfort. Able is a suffix which is added to the root and gives extra meaning or modifies the meaning. Okay, so this is what we mean by word structure. When I say uncomfortable, also we add a prefix, a part of UN, this UN, which is called a prefix because it comes before the word, it's pre, becomes before the word, and un has a meaning. It means not or no. So when I say comfortable, it means that I'm relaxed, I'm happy, okay. But when I say un, so it's the opposite. Okay, and able, it's the adjective. Okay, a comfortable chair, I can say a comfortable chair means I can sit relaxed on it. But uncomfortable means the opposite. So this is what we mean by word structure. Here, these two words which I have just given to you, helpful, unhelpful, comfortable, comfort, comfortable, uncomfortable, consist of three parts. Some words consist of more than that, Okay, maybe more than about three parts or three morphemes. So this is what we mean by word structure. Okay. طيب here it analyzes the structure of words. So now we will know when we analyze the word into its parts, when we analyze a structure into its parts, we have to understand the meaning of each part and the function of each part. We say able and comfortable, it changes the word, the verb comfort into an adjective, and un, it changes the meaning into the opposite, and in the word helpful, full changes the verb help into an adjective, and so on. So this is what we mean by analyzing word structure. Look at slide 3. A word consists of, we hear in slide 2, we have three words here, such that in the last line and the line before, such as stems, root words, prefixes, and suffixes, which are called affixes. Now, the first part is root, the root word. The root word, it's the root, which the root word cannot be divided into other parts. It's the word which carries the meaning. When I say boy, boy is a root word. Type. Boyish, it means he acts like, he's a man, but he acts like boys, boyish manners. Now here is an adjective. The root is boy, and the suffix which is added is ish. So when I say, as I said before, for example, comfortable, the root is comfort, and apple is the suffix. When I say, take the word destroy, destructive, and destruction. The root is destroy, the verb is destroy. Destruction, shin, it makes it a noun. And of course, it modifies the meaning. Okay, and when I say destructive, the ev, it changed the verb destroy into an adjective, okay? And of course, it modifies the meaning, and it is used in context to perform a different function, or it becomes a new part of speech. Destroy, a verb, destruction, a noun, destructive, an adjective. Also, the root word is destroy. Okay, all of these words belong to the word destroy. Okay, so this is the root. It means the main part which carries the meaning of the word. And the stem, it is the root added with the suffixes and the prefixes. This is the stem. And when I say destruction, it is a stem. When I say destructive, it is a stem. When I say boys, plural s, it is a stem. The root is boy, and the stem is boys. When I say boyish, the root is boy, and the stem is boyish, and so on. This is what we mean by stem, root, prefixes, and suffixes. Prefixes, like I have just explained, when I say unhelpful, un is the prefix, which two or three letters, but they have meaning, which is called a morpheme. We will discuss it later. It has a meaning, it means not. When I say impolite, it's an adjective, polite. When I say impolite, it's the opposite. M means the opposite. When I say right, it's a root. When I say rewrite, this re, it's a prefix. So impolite, m is a prefix. It comes before the word. Un is a prefix. It comes before the word. Re, it's a prefix. It comes before the word. So prefixes come before the root. Prefixes come before the root. Suffixes comes, or suffixes come after roots. Okay? So when I say, for example, helpful, full is a suffix. When I say information, inform is the verb. Shin is the suffix, which makes it a noun. It makes the verb a noun. Shin is a suffix. So this is what we mean by prefixes and suffixes. A morpheme before the word or a morpheme after the word. Together, suffixes and prefixes are called affixes. Okay? Now, so what I want you to do as an exercise, you drop it in the discussion part, and we will discuss it in the Zoom lecture, that you find 5 words. It's easy, it's a small number, 5 words. And you analyze them into root, prefix, and suffixes. And don't copy each other, and don't copy from the internet. Try to, okay, if you search for words from the internet, no problem, but I prefer that you use your own memory. We will discuss them in the Zoom lecture, okay? Now, let's come here to slide 3. What is a root? A root is the most basic part of a word which carries the fundamental meaning, the essential meaning, the main meaning, and cannot be further broken down. Cannot be broken down. What do you mean by broken down? We cannot analyze it to smaller parts. When I say information, inform, till, means tell. Shin, it means, it adds, shin, it becomes noun and it modifies the meaning. But when I say inform or help, I cannot break it into, when I say boy, girl, I cannot break it into smaller parts. When I say uncomfortable, I break it into small parts, comfort and able. Destructive, destroy, okay? You see, this is the long word is broken into smaller parts, but the main part is the root. The root cannot be broken into smaller parts. A stem is made up of a root plus derivational affixes or inflectional morphemes. Now, a stem is made up. The word made up, it means more than one part collected together. Made up of. So a stem is made up of a root, plus derivational affixes, suffixes and prefixes, or inflectional morphemes. Here we want to stop at the word inflectional morphemes. Actually, it's easy. Just maybe the terms you have to know. What do we mean by inflectional morphemes? We have 8 parts of inflectional morphemes. Plural S. The plural S is an inflectional morpheme. Muhammad plays, this third person S is an inflectional morpheme. Longer, ER, longer, ER, is an inflectional morpheme. The longest, EST, is an inflectional morpheme. And so on, we will explain them. This is what we mean by inflectional morphemes, which are added to the root Okay, so to make it a stem, they are added to root to make it a stem. So a stem is made up of a root plus derivational affixes, like we say boy, boyish, boy, boyish is a stem, comfortable is a stem with derivational affixes, prefixes and suffixes, or inflectional affixes like s, plural s, third person s, er, est for comparison and so on. It is the part of the word that can take inflectionals. Stem can take inflectionals. Okay, for example, the verbal root right, this here is an example. For example, the verbal root right, the word right, root, the root right. Can you break this word into smaller part, right? Can you break it into smaller part? No, how to break it? So it is a root. Okay. It can be added by take, or it can take various derivational affixes, prefixes and suffixes to form different stems. For one root, you can have many stems. For one root, you can have many stems. So look, rewrite, a prefix, rewrite, it is a verb. Overwrite, it is a verb also. Over, it's a prefix. Writer, suffix, it is a noun. Writer, the one who writes, it becomes a noun. Writing, it is a noun. These stems, in turn, can be inflected also. Any, this is a stem when you add it. These are stems. You add re, you add over, you add er, you add ing. All of these are affixes, derivational affixes, derivational. Now, the inflectional is the other eight parts. Then these stems in turn can be inflected. Inflected, yani you add, inflected means, I'm sorry, inflected means that you add plural s, third person s, er, est, and others. You see, they can be inflected. It becomes rewrites. You see, it has a derivational prefix in the beginning, re, re, and it has an inflectional morpheme, which is s, he writes, third personal person s. Rewriting, it becomes a noun. Rewrites is a verb. Rewriting, it becomes a noun with a prefix and an inflectional inflectional morpheme. Rewritten, rewritten, right, wrote, written, rewritten. It's also before and after. With en is the en, the third form of the verb, right, wrote, written. This en is an inflectional morpheme. And re is a derivational morpheme. Just you have to sit with yourself and to focus and to start analyzing words. It's enjoyable, it's lovely, I love it a lot, and you, I'm sure that you will love it, because you use your brain and you practice, you discover things, you discover relations, okay? And so on, rewrite can also be a stem by itself, and it can be inflected when you say writes without any derivational, only inflectional morpheme, writing and written. So roots and stems can be inflected. What is a morpheme? Now we see, we said the word morphology, morpheme. What is a morpheme? Let's define the morpheme. Morpheme is defined as the smallest speech unit which can have meaning and cannot be further divided. It can have meaning and cannot be divided. Look here. Examples of morphemes. Boy is a morpheme. Can you break it into smaller parts? No. Desk, fire, school. They are words, but also a morpheme can be a suffix or a prefix or an inflectional morpheme. Affixes. Affixes are derivational. We call them derivational morphemes. And inflection, the third part is the inflectional morphemes, which as I told you, plural S, third person S, ER, EST, past tense, third verb, and so on. Okay, so a morpheme is defined as the smallest speech unit. The smallest parts of language which has meaning and cannot be further divided into other parts, into a smaller part, cannot break it. This is a morpheme. Okay. Free and bound morphemes. What are the types of morphemes? Now, take 1 minute to revise the previous ideas. Let's go back. I'll go back with you to slide one. Look here. Morphology and word formation. Can you look at it again? What is morphology and what is word formation? Take notes. If you have anything that you don't understand, you can ask me about in the Zoom lecture. Two, what is a root and what is a stem? Now four, what is a morpheme? And now, free and bound morpheme. What do you mean by free morpheme and bound morpheme? Free morpheme, what is it? It is the morpheme that can occur as a single word with meaning, as act in actor. Now, look, it is the root. Yani we can say free morpheme. A root of a word is a free morpheme that can carry the meaning. Now, it can stand alone and gives meaning alone without any other additions or without any other morphemes. Look at the word, for example, actor. The free morpheme is act. The free morpheme is comfort. The free morpheme is play. The free morpheme is help. Okay, so a free morpheme is the morpheme that can occur as a single word with meaning, as act in actor. Now, or is a bound morpheme. Can I say or as a word? Do you understand something if I say or? It's not or. Or is a word and it has meaning. But here, or, can I, when I say teacher, teach is a free morpheme. Er, teacher, er, is that, does it have meaning? Er, alone. When I say destructive, destroy is a free morpheme. If extracted. If it's a bound morpheme, does it have meaning alone? Alone can stand alone. Okay, it has a function that it changes the word into an adjective, but does it have, can it stand alone? This is the point. Can it stand alone and gives meaning alone? If I write the word, for example, un, if you find the word un, the morpheme un, okay, you know it is a morpheme, and it means not when you look at it morphologically and grammatically, but can it act as an independent word? No, it's not a word. Here, for example, examples of free morphemes: girl, system, consider, hope, act, fall, happy. All these are free morphemes. Bound morphemes. What do you mean by bound morphemes? Morphemes, as I told you, they are the affixes. They are the affixes, the prefixes, and the suffixes. Bound morpheme, it is the morpheme that cannot stand alone as a single word, like or in actor. It has meaning only when connected to other morphemes. Un, for example. Un, as I told you, un. It has meaning when it is connected to a root. Uncover. Okay, cover and cover. Do and do. This pleased, disappear. Appear can be seen, and disappear, it means hidden. Connect, disconnect, all of these are prefixes. Okay, they are bound morphemes because they cannot act as independent words. They have meaning when they are connected to roots. Predetermine, prejudge, singer like ER, singer, ist like typist, pianist, ly like manly, friendly, unkindness, unkindness, and so on. Now, ness, ist, pre, li, un, m, all of this, all of these are bound morphemes because they have meaning only when they are connected to other words. Now, also another type, another aspect of morphemes. We said if we want to talk about characteristics of morphemes, we say they are either bound morphemes or free morphemes. Another characteristics of morpheme, lexical and functional morphemes. Free morphemes fall in two categories. The first category is called lexical morphemes. It is a set of ordinary nouns, adjectives, adverbs. It is the content words, noun, adjectives, and verbs and adverbs. Now, they carry the content of the message we convey. What do you mean by that? Content words carry the message we convey. When I say children, boys and girls, or children have been playing in the garden since the morning. Children have been playing in the garden since the morning. If I say only I focus on the content word, which are the children play garden morning, children play garden morning. Can you get the meaning? Can you make a mental image, form a mental image of the idea? Children play morning garden, or garden morning. Can you guess the content idea? Yes. So by these content words, children, play, garden, morning, we understand that children play, are playing, have been playing. You can get the meaning even if you don't get the specific grammatical details. Now, these four words, children, play, morning, garden, these are the content words. But when you say have been, it is a functional word. It's something in grammatical, something related to grammar. It tells me that they have been playing for since the morning for or up to now, from the morning up to now. Okay, it gives more details to the meaning, but I cannot use them alone. If I say children have been, the children or children are in the garden in the morning. Children have been garden morning. This has been, what does it mean to me? In the garden, if I say in alone, children are playing in, and another in for evening or afternoon. This in alone, what does it do for me? Nothing, I understand nothing. When I say have been alone without the word play, it means nothing, but have been playing with the content word play and some grammatical aspects gives the details about the meaning. So the content words carries the main message. Okay, let's see the functional words, as you see here, and, but, and even when you look at, when you write, I buy oranges, comma, meat, comma, cheese, comma, and bread. You see, this comma replaces the functional word, replaces and. Actually, we say wa, wa, in Arabic we say wa, wa, wa. Okay, in English you put comma, comma, comma. It's not necessary for the meaning. Even in Arabic we say, we بدنا خبز جبنا لبنا. Okay, we don't need to use wa. So because they are functional words, you see, functional words like and, but, when, because, the subordinator because and subordinator when, and the coordinator but, and on, a preposition, near, an adverb of place, above, in, the, these, them, all of these are functional words. They are not content words. Eight. Now, affixes. What do you mean by affixes? What are affixes? It means suffixes and prefixes. Prefixes before the root and suffix after the root. A simple word consists of a free base morpheme, which is the root. A complex word consists of a base morpheme, which is the root, and other elements. The other elements are bad morpheme. As I have explained, when I said, for example, destruction, the main or the root word is destroy, and chin is the functional, is a morpheme, is the suffix. Okay? Bound morpheme, it is the bound morpheme that can be attached to the beginning, at the beginning or at the end. So affixes, you can put it in two branches, which are suffixes and prefixes. Now here this is a form, the word of a base unhappily is made of three morphemes. So this is what I want to do as an exercise. You analyze, you also find other words and you analyze them into prefix, root or base or three morpheme and suffix. Okay, I want other five words, so you will have 10 words. Okay, and we will have them in the discussion. Because without the practice, you will not learn. These elements are called affixes. The one, the first one, which is prefix, okay, the first one, which is prefix, root. Now, unhappily, un is a prefix, happy is the root or the main word or the base word, and the suffix, it's a bound morpheme. So the prefix and the suffix are bound morphemes, and the root word or the base word is the free morpheme. So this is another exercise that you have to do. What do you mean by derivational morphemes and inflectional morphemes? Still we are talking about morphemes. We talked about the parts, the types of morphemes, which are either free or bound. And also we talked about the position of morphemes, free, the suffixes, free, pre or after the root. Now here we want to talk about derivational and inflectional morphemes. What do you mean by derivational? They are the suffixes and the prefixes. Suffixes and the prefixes, as the examples I gave to you, when I say, she dances happily. Happily, happy, L-Y. The L-Y is a derivational morpheme. Okay. He works harder than before. E-R is an inflectional morpheme. Harder. Harder, comparison. He works, S works is an inflectional morpheme. He works harder than before. He works, works. This S, the third person S, is an inflectional morpheme. Harder, more than before. The ER is an inflectional morpheme. However, he is successful. Successful, here success is the noun and full, it becomes an adjective. So this is a derivational morpheme. The inflectional morphemes are only 8. Derivational morphemes are many, and you will learn them all and you will use them in sentences. The usefulness of this course that I'll give you a lot of practice how to use the derivational morphemes. Particular derivational morphemes will enrich your vocabulary, will teach you how to use speech parts, different speech parts in context, how to use them correctly. Okay? طيب. Derivational morphemes, they can be suffixes or prefixes, as I told you. They involve change in the word meaning. They modify the meaning. And when I say help, it's the action. Help me. He is helpful. It's something else. It's an adjective. So you see, so different meaning. Okay, it is related to the root meaning, but it is modified in another way. Okay, so they change in the word meaning and class or part of speech. Of course, when I say destroy is a verb, when I say destruction, it's a noun. So you change the part of speech. You know the parts of speech: verbs, nouns, adjectives, adverb, preposition, conjunction, and interjections. Okay? So these are the parts of speech. When you add a suffix, you change the root word into, if it is a verb, maybe it becomes an adjective, or maybe it becomes a noun. So, part of speech, as you see, it changes, the involves change in word meaning and the class or part of speech. Unhappy. For example, unhappy, a change in meaning. Okay. Unhelpful, now, or helpful, let's say helpful, change in word class. Help verb, helpful adjective. But in rich, now rich, a man, a wealthy man who has a lot of money. But in rich, it changes the adjective rich into a verb to make someone rich. In rich, to make someone rich. In rich, it changes the class from adjective to verb. Look at this piece of information, derivational affixes always precede, come before inflectional ones if they come in the same word. What does that mean? Okay, for example, the word modern. Modernize, now modern is an adjective. Modernize, it becomes a verb. Like we say Palestine, Palestinize, make something Palestinian, make the books Palestinian, make the curriculum Palestinian. So this is an, this suffix makes an adjective into verb, makes the adjective into verb. It is a derivational morpheme. And here the S is the third person S. It means in now derivational morphemes come before inflectional morphemes in one word. No other affixes are added after the inflectional morphemes. Yani always the inflectional morphemes is the last thing. Inflectional affixes or morphemes are suffixes. They are suffixes, pay attention, they are suffixes, elements that are added to the end of a word. So they are suffixes, they cannot, inflectional morphemes cannot be before, prefixes, they are always after the word, they don't come at the beginning of the word, there are only 8 inflectional morphemes, which, as I told you before, and I'll add another slide here. They are third person singular, plural, ER comparison, EST comparison, EST comparison, and ED past tense, and EN third person. Okay, all of these are inflectional morphemes. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. This is the end of this class. Thank you. Remember that you have 2 pieces of homework. Do them for the discussion in the Zoom.